I will focus on the chapter 8, which is on trade and investment, and I will highlight a series of challenges. I really appreciated the report, and I find that in particular highlighting the necessity of focusing on the structural transformation is really, really important. However, even if it is an extremely relevant objective, enhancing productive capacity and social transformation, I will highlight the key constraints and challenges which are implied, and in particular the difficulty for any policies, including EU policy, for addressing these constraints and challenges. These challenges are mostly long-term challenges, and I will provide a few graphs showing the difficulty of achieving structural transformation for LDC. So this one. Firstly, three big issues. First, it seems to me that the report should insist a bit more on uncertainties. I mean, yes, investment is shifting toward developing countries. There are many positive dimensions of this South-South cooperation and so on. But at the same time, and I saw that it will be presented in 2 days at ODI, the next World Bank report on capital for the future insists that uncertainties are prevailing concerning trade and investment, and in particular commodity prices. As Machikoni Sanke has highlighted, there is a strong correlation between poor countries and commodity-dependent countries, which is well known, and a key driver of improvement in the global landscape of trade and investment is obviously China. And so China, as everybody knows, is rebalancing its growth and its growth model. And most paper trying to understand the consequences for developing countries and poor countries are extremely ambiguous. And that typically for hard commodities, typically metal and so on, shifting towards domestic consumption can have many negative consequences on particular metals, so hard commodities, which can have negative consequences, obviously, for the producer of these commodities. So firstly, uncertainties regarding commodity prices. Second, regarding trade in general, global trade and investment at the global level. So the positive side, so just to insist on these uncertainties, positive side, obviously, China increase in unit labor cost, maybe windows of opportunities for LDCs and LICs, obviously. But at the same time, the ambiguous effect are that typically high prices, so this is we are really in a very difficult dilemma, because whether low prices or high prices have negative consequences. Typically high prices, commodity prices for commodity producing countries may lock in these producing country and producing incentive for remaining in that particular export structure. And it is exactly the same for investment. I mean, as is well known, typically China mode investment of investment in Africa, called the so-called Angola mode, as a kind of barter commodity for infrastructure deal, typically is also an incentive for remaining in this type of investment structure. Positive side, so this is why I insist on the ambiguity and ambivalence of what is going on in the next decade, in the next short and medium term. Positive side is, as Kaplinsky has shown, the spillover, even commodities can generate spillover effect and be incrementally the first basis of industrialization. So first point is uncertainties. So what could be the role of Asian drivers? And this, now I am moving to more structural long-term issues. That is not only Asian driver associated with uncertainties, but it is unlikely that these Asian drivers can be triggering this important structural transformation. The first graph is export of Sub-Saharan Africa to G8 countries. The second one is to China, and the third one is to Brazil. And what is in black is fuel. So that is mostly, typically, Sub-Saharan Africa as a continent is exporting, as everybody knows, fuel, I mean commodities, so this is a fuel exporter. But what is interesting is that Brazil, for instance, emerging country, and China don't modify this export structure. And even Brazil, I was surprised when I made the graph, is doing worse, I mean, I would say, if I may say. So, second point is the issue of divergence. That is, if we reason on the long term, we can see that the broad picture is not the catch-up picture, which is what we learn at university, but it is much more a story of divergence of the long term. The first one is starting in the mid-19th century. And we can see that in blue it is Western country and so on. So naturally Africa is at the lowest level. But what we see in the first graph is not a convergent story at all. The second graph is particularly obvious and, I'm very sorry, very depressing. That is, this is Sub-Saharan Africa and the world. And we start in 1960. So the key issue is, as I wanted to ask, that is, what is the power of policy? And this is exactly the debate I would like to trigger. What type of policy that is to go even stronger in terms of EU policy or whatever policy that is to break this type of pattern? We need very, very proactive policies. Another graph which is also showing on the long term, what is the story? Coming from Danny Roderick, this is convergence gap in productivity. We can see that Africa, what Roderick has highlighted, the convergence gap in terms of, it's not productivity, it is the different percent of developed country incomes. For Africa, it is wider than in the 90s, which is a yellow dotted line. Also, another structural long-term issue is what is called the so-called middle income trap. It's not so difficult, perhaps, I mean, with high prices and so on, to reach, I would say, the middle income, to catch up from low income to middle income. And this type of graph show that, I mean, then it is much more difficult, and it is exactly the issue of social transformation to catch up to higher income level. This is another way of showing half empty, half full story. That is, Latin America, by the way, it is Sub-Saharan Africa, green and blue, this is the share of export in world export. We can have a pessimist and positive story. That is, we can see East Asia as a total outlier in this story, in a way. But also, we can observe that two parts of the world are obviously, over the long term, I mean, this is 1948, not doing well in terms of trade. So, very well-known issue, that is, Sub-Saharan Africa is heavily depending on commodity for exports. So naturally, oil countries are typical of this story. So Angola, Chad, and so more than 80%, 90%. What is the result of that? Is the share in global export. This graph shows two things. First, over half a century, the decline, this is long term. What kind of, again, what type of policy can address this? A steady decline. At the same time, in terms of value, I mean, Africa did well, that is in red, in terms of value, the value of export is, I mean, we have the crisis, is doing very well. At the same time, there is a second story, which I don't know the how to explain it fully, exactly what has been highlighted in chapter 8 and the work of Machiko on the commodity as driver of growth. In 2002, we can see that the green line, I don't know what will happen, but obviously something is happening in 2010, and this line is a bit less pessimistic. Also, I mean, what type of policy can address the fact that growth rates, this is for Sub-Saharan Africa, are obviously strongly driven by commodity prices. We have two series of prices, energy, non-energy. In blue, this is growth rate. So we can see first, they are very volatile. And second, they are strongly co-moving with non-energy prices. And energy is in green. We can see that before the so-called super cycle in 2002, this is a reverse correlation. Typically, the shock obviously has been in 1973 has been associated to a decrease in growth. So the story here, the question is the question of Easterly. I mean, is growth driven by good luck or good policies? And this is, I think, exactly the issue. That is, Easterly, very long time ago, so in 1993, in a very famous paper, Good Luck or Good Policy, said, I mean, if growth rates are driven by external shocks, exchange rate, US exchange rate, and so on, there is absolutely no relevance of domestic policy. And this is naturally a very depressing, I would say, story. I have two more slides. So, the shock naturally over the long term. So the report doesn't address, I think, something which is very important. That is, which taxation policy? That is, these low-income countries, commodity-dependent countries, typically rely on commodities and volatile price, obviously, for their revenues. And we see this is in the second graph. It is 20 points of GDP, that is the 2008 crisis, has been associated with a loss of 20 points of GDP loss for typically oil producing countries. That is, this type of shock are absolutely enormous. It has been said in the report and in Machiko paper that the report insists, the EU policies mostly insist on facilities. So I would say that facilities clearly are not enough. I mean, shock are not enough because, I mean, firstly, they are not enough because they don't address structural long-term problems, but also the amount, the volume of funds which would be necessary for addressing this type of shocks can obviously are beyond the scope of. And this is the last graph that is also structural issues, that is an obvious negative relationship between volatility of growth and growth, GDP per capita. So, and I conclude. I have to conclude?
Fairly soon.
Yeah, exactly. So I conclude in saying that Roderick highlighted that social transformation is something which is much more difficult for commodity-dependent countries. Why? Because there is a paradox that high prices are incentive to remain in the export of commodities. Second, demography. That is, demography is a bit under-addressed in the report in the sense that demography clearly impedes structural transformation. And then the issue of the role of the state. I mean, for implementing trade policies and relevant developmental state-type trade and investment policies, which have been the model of Asian state, that is, coordination, addressing coordination failure, information failure, market failure, externality, uncertainty, and all these stories. I mean, states which are capable of implementing policies are absolutely necessary. And precisely, there is a very strong association, which is typical of low-income country, of weak states unable to implement policy and the fact that they are low-income states. So thank you. I'm very...
Alice, thank you. That was really a tremendous overview. So thank you. And I actually think, you know, you raise one of the really fundamental questions behind some of these graphs, is that, which the question being is that if this is indeed a commodity super cycle, and we're on a sort of long run trajectory of higher real prices for commodities, what are the conditions for converting that into changes in those global market share graphs? I mean, how do countries move up the value chain and capture larger global market shares? And which what are the policies required for that? So what I'd like to do now, I think we'll take the questions in clusters of three or four. Four if you're disciplined and ask short questions. Three if you're non-disciplined and ask longer questions. So who would like to, we have a microphone as well, I think. And if I could ask people just to say who they are when they ask their questions, and who they in particular want to address the question to.